How many times have you gone on an online streaming site, not knowing what to watch, and been completely confused by the amount of options to choose from, scrolling through tons of content for way too long before getting tired and dropping the entire idea? Like every other good thing in life, can too much choice be bad? Well, let's see how the 2009 sci-fi movie Mr. Nobody deals with the subject of choice. A 9-year-old Nemo is thrust into a position where he must make an impossible decision. His parents are getting a divorce, and he's asked to decide whether he wants to go away with his mother or stay back with his father. An infinity of possibilities rise from this decision. As long as he doesn't choose, anything is possible. The film is an imagining of all possible futures arising out of Nemo's choice at this moment. But each choice leads to more decisions to be made, and as he goes further down his multiple imagined lives, Nemo finds himself more confused about the choice he must make as a 9-year-old boy. Nemo's inability to make a decision can be attributed to what psychologists refer to as choice overload. In this video, we take a look at why choice overload happens, how it impacts our decisions, and ways to navigate situations of overload. You can find the transcripts of this video and all the academic references on gonudgeyourself.com. And if you like the video, remember to subscribe to the channel for more content on human mind, brain, and behavior. Now, let's get started. Choice overload is a phenomenon wherein a large number of options may lead to delayed or deferred decisions, poor choice, and dissatisfaction, especially if all the options are relevant and a good decision is personally important. A related phenomenon and one of the causes of choice overload is information overload, which means that our performance at an information processing task improves as we receive more information, but only up to a certain point, beyond which our performance declines with further information. One of the most influential studies about choice overload was conducted at the entrance of an upscale grocery store, where a tasting table was set up, displaying either a small assortment containing 6 jams or a large assortment of 24 jams. Every individual who approached the table received a coupon to get $1 off the purchase of any jam of that brand. Although more people approached the tasting table when it displayed 24 jams, only 3% of them redeemed the coupon for a jam. On the other hand, 30% of all people who saw the small assortment of 6 jams went ahead and actually bought one of the jams with a coupon. So, while more people looked at the larger assortment, they were 10 times more likely to actually make a purchase from the smaller assortment. To understand choice overload better, let's start by looking at its cognitive causes, which are the psychological mechanisms that explain the phenomenon. First, the information overload hypothesis suggests that we can only process a limited amount of information in given time. But if a task requires more information to be processed than our individual capacity, our performance at the task suffers. Therefore, adding more options makes decisions more complex and hence more difficult and frustrating. Information overload makes a thorough evaluation of all options seem undesirable from a time and effort perspective, thus inducing fears of not being able to make the best decision. Now, having a limited time to decide further amplifies the effects of choice overload. Secondly, choosing from a large number of options also means rejecting a large number of alternatives. Having more discarded alternatives produces more opportunities for regret to emerge, and the attractiveness of the chosen option may seem somewhat diminished compared to the combined attractiveness of all the non-chosen options. This regret and counterfactual thinking dampen people's enthusiasm for their choice. Lastly, large assortments increase our expectations and shift our ideal points in a way that makes them harder to attain. Given a large number of options, each with some appealing attributes, may make us desire an option with a combination of all the attributes that appeal to us. Now, such an option may not even exist in the choice set. Next, let's look at what's going on in the brain when we are experiencing choice overload. Activity in the striatum and the anterior cingulate cortex seems to represent the value we attach to the entire choice set, which is distinct from the value we attach to independent options within the set. Now, striatum plays a key role in our risk and reward valuations, while anterior cingulate cortex is involved in detection of conflicting information and situations. Activity in the two regions resembles an inverted U-shaped function of the choice set size, that is, increasing with more choice up to a certain point, and then decreasing. So too much conflicting preferences for different options may be lowering our preference towards the entire choice set. But why does choice overload occur? After all, having a large choice set means a higher likelihood of us finding the perfect match as per our requirements. It also gives us more confidence that we have selected a high quality option. So why didn't we evolve a preference for larger choice sets? Well, actually we did. And that is the reason that our decision quality and our satisfaction levels increase with initial expansion of choice sets. But size is a relative measure, and what was a large choice set for our early ancestors is not considered large enough in this age of abundance of choice and information explosion. So we inherited a preference and processing capacity for a choice set which was large enough by the standards of our ancestors, but not by today's standards. Now let's look at some of the undesirable impacts of choice overload on our decisions. First, faced with choice overload, we tend to defer decisions or are just unable to make a choice because evaluating all the options is too cumbersome a task. And without a thorough evaluation of all options, we don't feel confident about our choice. This tendency is known as decision paralysis. And this is what happens when we can't decide what to watch on Netflix because there are just too many equally appealing or equally unappealing options. Secondly, choice overload increases our reliance on heuristic decision making. Now, some of the common heuristic strategies used by people include choosing the recommended option, choosing the default option, choosing the most easily justifiable option, or choosing the most easily understood option. Now, heuristic decision making may be the best strategy in many cases, but not always, such as situations where the recommending agent's interests may not necessarily be aligned with our interests. An example of this are high-stakes sales situations. A recommending agent not perceived as reliable can actually increase decision paralysis and lower decision confidence. Next, faced with choice overload, we often experience dissatisfaction for not being able to evaluate all the alternatives thoroughly and feel regret over discarding some of the appealing alternatives. Now, these negative emotions about our decisions can unfold over and last a long time, making us more willing to change our selection if an opportunity is available in the future. A study found that online daters who were presented with a larger pool as opposed to a smaller pool of potential partners experienced lower satisfaction with their choice and were more willing to change their partners in the future. And finally, information anxiety is a condition of stress caused by the inability to access, understand, or make use of necessary information. And a key cause of this is information overload. An example of this is the anxiety and dissonance caused by the glut of news sources available today, many of them with contradicting perspectives. Another example is the stress caused by overconsumption and overcommunication on social media platforms. And before we conclude, let's look at some strategies to navigate situations of choice overload and strategies to design choice sets better as to avoid such situations. Firstly, we don't experience choice overload if we are already familiar with the options or have established preferences in that category. Secondly, categorizing the options within the choice set can help reduce choice overload by reducing the amount of information that we need to process while still preserving the variety within the choice set. Next, choice overload disappears if there's an obviously dominant option within the choice set. Indeed, adding a number of inferior alternatives to a choice set with a dominant option increases our confidence in selecting that option, as we are satisfied that we have compared it with a number of alternatives. Next, the effects of choice overload are amplified by time pressure and choice accountability, that is, the need to justify our choices to others. So easing time and accountability pressures can reduce choice overload. Next, decision makers can be guided towards the most important information by helping them identify which attributes of the options are likely to contribute the most towards overall quality and their own satisfaction. Next, people can be initially presented a smaller choice set and given the option to look at a larger one if they so choose. Next, our decision goals and strategies can increase or reduce our likelihood of experiencing choice overload. For example, if we are trying to maximize, that is, choose the relative best option in the given set, we may experience choice overload. On the other hand, if we are satisfying, that is, looking for an option that meets our minimum requirements, we may avoid overload. Using other simplifying decision heuristics, such as choosing an easily understood or easily justifiable option, may also reduce the occurrence of choice overload. And finally, information filtering tools, recommendation agents, and default options are shown to improve decision quality, particularly in complex choice situations, as long as they are perceived as reliable by decision makers. And to conclude, let's look back at the story of Nemo. For a 9-year-old child, even two options are too much if the choice is between his mother and father. As he imagines the various possibilities, each alternative life seems to have its ups and downs, but each seems worth living. Even if he chooses the best alternative in his situation, there is much he will miss out on. Anticipation of this regret makes the decision so difficult. Go watch the movie to find out Nemo's choice. And now it's your turn to tell us in the comments below about situations where you experienced choice overload. And stick to this channel to learn about human behaviors. No need to overload yourself with other options. See you next time.